everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Jacksnax. Today we're going to talk about Trey Anastasio's epic solo on Backwards Down the Number Line. All right, that's our first lick here. All right, Backwards Down the Number Line starts with this one fret bend up from A to B flat, high E string, 17th fret. Two of them, and then slightly past the B flat, but not getting all the way to B natural. Back to G with a little Clapton vibrato, this kind of thing. Reach up pinky to the B natural. That's kind of a funky note, okay? Descending natural third, flat three, B flat, right? With the ring finger, and then this is all happening on the high E. Okay, and then we slide up on the G string to the third of our G chord. Like that, okay? So that's gonna be three, five, six, one. Okay? And then I think we hit it three times there. Yeah. Right, like that, all right? And the main things to focus on here is the bend, not going past the B flat on the first one. Do not go. It's way too happy. It's more of a blues sound. Then. Okay, that and the Clapton vibrato style here is really what's gonna sell it. So this is definitely more complex than the first lick, right? So we've come out of, then we come back for the same kind of approach. We come up to the 16th fret G string. All right, so that's the third, five, six, and then we slide from five back to three, okay? These are intervals, not frets. If you're talking frets, 15 to 12, okay? So, once we do that, right to the 12th fret, so up the G string, then tag the B at the 12, and then the C at 13. Right? So Trey actually kind of clams it a little bit. I think he slides up with his middle finger to the 13th fret by mistake, because he's thinking of, if you slow it down really slow like I did using the Vidami looper here, is actually what he plays, but I can't do it. I just slide up with my index finger, I made a point of. And that way I never hit that clam. Okay, so the way that lick works is there's this little pause. Pause, and then, so that's, and this right here is kind of the hallmark of Trey's arpeggiated style, is this upstrokes. I don't know if he's alternating or whatever. I find it easier to kind of go, so I'm doing upstrokes. Kind of pumping a little bit so that I can mute with both my left hand and my right hand is kind of, you know, already muffling a little bit. Okay, and you got to maintain that that dynamic control. So all in so far. Then we're gonna slide up. To this B. Okay, so we slide up to the B on the 14th fret of the A string. That's actually where he slides from, oddly enough, the 11th fret. I don't like the way it sounds so much, so I just kind of do an ambiguous to get the effect. But if you really want to dial it in, that G sharp and that G sharp are both hit in this one lick, but I kind of avoid them, okay? So octave B's, right? B, and then B on the 12th fret, high, well, not high, but B string. And then we slide down. That's a slur. So you pick on the G at the 12th and slide back two frets. Okay, then we're gonna come up here and tag the C note with that pinky, then pivot back to the F note we were just on with the index finger. Sorry. And that kind of gears us up for this downstroke, where we do a very quick pre-bend and release back from C to B, but we don't just bend it for no reason. We strike it while it's up there and bring it down very quickly. So that would sound like. Okay, and I'm actually making a mistake in that I come up into that C note and I'm immediately doing vibrato. I believe he kind of lets it just sit a little bit more flat. So. Then a little wiggle. Okay, so all in. So this next little chunk has some of the more complicated elements of Trey's style kind of baked into it. Very fascinating idea, though. He's got this idea of coming from this G shape to this G shape to this kind of F shape. Okay, and then finally back to here, this part of a C chord. So bear in mind, we're still playing over a G chord over the Mixolydian scale, like this kind of. Then the same notes, but just gravitating towards F. So that's going to make that F Lydian. Right? F Lydian, right? And then. Just C major. Now they're all connected to C major. They all are the same notes, right? But we're just shifting the gravity. Or the weight, where we resolve the line. So over the G chord, we want to resolve to the chord tones of the G chord, F and C likewise, okay? So we're gonna come up, we're gonna form this little G arpeggio shape. All right, this is how you think about it. We're gonna hammer on from the 5 to the 6 on the B string at the 15th and 17th fret, okay? And you're gonna wanna keep it nice and, kind of punctuated. All right, and one of the ways he does that is rather than playing the full arpeggio, it's just kind of too rich. I think he just goes, okay, there's definitely a little, a little chicka right before it. And that's easiest done by, after you play the last line, to put your pick up on the D string and then just rake through. Okay? Then we're going to slide back from the B, the string, this D note down to here at the B at the 12th fret. Okay, and at that point you can start to employ some of the pick posture that you, the pick position that you have to have for these kind of upward. He really likes that upstroke pick harmonic trick. I don't think he's doing it he certainly probably wasn't doing it the same way every time. I'm not sure if this was a composed solo or not. If he just winged it, that's pretty amazing. But at will, Trey is accessing these upper order harmonics and stuff with these upstrokes, which is really cool. Best way to think about it is that. Try to vision the string being plucked by the tip of the pick and then quickly touching the chubby part of your index finger. Regardless of how you hold, I don't all of a sudden wing the tip of my finger like that. I think I'm doing it more like that, okay? Not dead on the center, but more like that. And so that way. You gotta get that technique together to really nail this stuff. All right, so we're coming in with this little rake, a little hammer on to the root, then a slide from 5 to 3, right? Back up to the 15th fret with our pinky. And then we're just gonna do this little sequence. Right, and that's straight down the arpeggio. So. Those are the notes to make it from the G chord to the F chord. Okay, but you wanna make sure you're putting the right kind of inflections in there. Okay, so then once we come here, right? We do a position shift with our ring finger to the 12th fret A string and come up into the third of the G chord. Okay, and we kind of pivot back and forth between the D string 12th fret and the 14th fret on the A string, right? And then we flatten out our index finger onto the G and kind of make sure that the point where we're applying pressure is closer to the first knuckle rather than the tip. Otherwise, we end up getting both the D and the G string to sound. We're not trying to do that. We're not in Skinner, right? All right, I even inch my finger down just a little bit. But you can do it either way. All right, and that's making the change from the G chord to this F chord once we slide. All right, then we position shift again, ring finger to like the E or this E flat note, and we kind of slide up into the F real fast. Two times, and then we go, it's gonna be AAG on the B string, starting 10th fret down to the 8th fret, okay? So, no vibrato, just let it go sine wave, right? Then we pluck again, A, and slide up to G, and again, flat, like a sine wave, until the very end, we give it a little wiggle, like that. And you can do it with a downward rake to get a thumb, slight harmonic, like that. He's got a little upper harmonic there, but I don't hear the rake. That leads me to think it's probably an upstroke, but that and maybe a little feedback or something like that from his guitar, which is certainly at concert levels, you know, or definitely stage levels there. All right, and then just let it go on the B note, all right? You don't have to, that's a pull off, I think, and then you could use your index finger and be in position for the next lick, or you can just do, and then shift there. Very sweet little section. I'll break that down in a second for you. All right, this next little chunk is all played right here between the 12th and 15th frets, and we're doing a lot of little nuanced little pick strokes and creating a percussive kind of bouncing, you know, this kind of thing, right? Okay, so to put it in context, we're coming up from the 10th fret to the 12th fret on the B string. Shift. So that's 12, 12, B, G. Then again. So B, G, B, G, and then a quick little bend. Right? All right, like that, so. Okay, finally up to the A. Okay. Okay, So we come up and finally hit that A at the 14th fret on the G string. And then we start pivoting back and forth again. 3 root, 5 root, right? Now that all works nicely because we're playing either G chord tones or C chord tones, and kind of implying a major 7 add 9 sound. Or over the G chord. Over the F, that sounds even cooler. We got some nice Lydian sounds. Okay, so he's taking full advantage of the fact that all these notes work in some capacity over the three chords he's soloing over, but he's definitely, you know, leaning towards this ascending. The point of this whole bit is he starts here, you know, then comes here, then comes here, and then he starts to come up here. And then eventually we end up climaxing all the way up at the top fret of my guitar, 22nd fret. He's got 24, but don't let that discourage you. You can play this on a standard 22 fret guitar, no problem. All right, so we come up. And that's that whole lick, okay? And if you want, you can get a little bit more bounce out of it by that kind of where you're a little bit more playful with an upstroke. Really mute the bouncing back and forth. And then add little harmonics periodically to punctuate your line. Okay. I'll give you the alternate. I like the hammer-on. I think that's what it sounds like he's doing. Okay. So we come up F, E, D, C, right? Now the thing to bear in mind is that D is a long D. It does not have a pause between it. It's just, okay? That's the distinguishing part of this first time of playing. There's three times he plays this idea up in here. The first time is this, okay? Long D. Then the second time he does a little tiny rig. Okay, so that's 6-3-6-3-5, right? Sorry. Like that. So we're out of this G shape. Getting the 6 of the G chord. So this is on the second time, okay? So first time is long to C, 6-6, short, and then ta-da. So it's like, you got the double sixes, same idea, F, E, D, short, and then, okay? Coming up on the third time now, another little rake, like that. You want that little dead note, right? Because the downstroke of that dead note will give you the ability to do the upstroke pinch harmonic. Okay, and then again. Now, that last one here is fraught with peril. If you really want to play it like him, he actually hits this C sharp by mistake very briefly, right? So he does. I tend to just put my finger there out of tribute to him and then, but not really fret it because I don't like the way it sounds, but he gets away with it just fine, okay? So, first one. So long, then 6-6, short, ta-da. All right, and that's the last of the development of that idea. So that's, okay. So, just playing around with that D, the C, and the B, right? Again, lots of that searing octave up effect that happens with that upstroke pinch harmonic, okay? And those are those three. They're kind of all, you know, related. Long, okay, rakes, 6-6, short, ta-da, and then, right, so that's tagging this A note with a pinky, or pull off from F. Very clean on that G, A, okay? That's very much. We're gonna just slide up one fret and let it just linger flat, no vibrato, right? Then we reapply the vibrato on the B, A, and G strings. Like that, okay? So. All right, we come back to that G, and then we come in with one of these like killer arpeggio licks. I'll be back in a second to break it down. This is one of my favorite licks from this solo. So we're gonna slide up using our middle finger right up here to the third of our G chord. That's gonna be at the 16th fret G string. Okay. And we're gonna do a hammer-on from 5 to 6 to the root. Slide from the 5 back to 3. So that's 15 to 12 on the B string. Pinky comes down and tags the D note again. And at that point, we start pivoting to other chord tones, namely the G at the 12th fret G string. Get that together, and you got the opening part of this lick, which is pretty fast. So then we're gonna come and grab that 13th fret B, okay, and do a little trill. See that pull off there? That gives us time to get to the next string. Right, so that's the A note at the 14th fret G string. Okay, so that's A, and then we go back to that B, and then believe it or not, we hit it again. Okay? After the second B, we hop strings and come to the D and hit it and slide back one fret, okay, and then slide back up to the D. So once we slide back to the D, we're gonna start doing one of these little pivot licks, right? So that's where it's probably the hardest bit, is getting that arpeggio to ring out nice and articulated as we come down. Okay, otherwise it goes, and it gets all yucky. All right, so you gotta learn to roll or pump. All right, so I bar and pump. And I'm doing upstrokes with those little, try to get the little sparkly pinch harmonic thing. Second B, pivot, bend, then we bend, and this is a nice slow bend. We do not rush to get up to this B from A, okay? And we don't go, we're not doing like a, we're not bending into the five, we're bending up to and grabbing that E note at the 12th fret. Take your time. Now, if you really slow down the recording, like you can with YouTube, you're going to hear a G sharp in there. I'm omitting it. I believe he does. There's some weird little out note in there. That G sharp is in there like three times in this solo, right? In the beginning, he slides up instead of, and then he slides from, which is really weird, rather. I think it's just part of him going for it, but if he was intending on using that many G sharps, he's an outside feller. All right, so. Okay, so what do? We bend that. I'm usually using my middle finger. And I give a good little raking. Come back to that A note. And so I tag that E back to A, and then I start coming. Once I hit that D, I flatten out my finger and I start pumping. Okay? Okay, so. I think I sometimes slide up into it like that, which I think is a mistake. I don't think he actually does that. All right, but that's one of the fancier licks in this song. Really amazing. As if that last lick wasn't enough, there's more arpeggios and triadic madness courtesy of Big Red. Okay, and that's kind of the tightest way to play it, okay? He kind of does those little, where he's sliding and pumping, and he's really, really hauling ass during that section. So, okay, it's that kind of deal. So that little glissy slide from G to F. Okay, then he skips the third and goes straight up to the fifth. Okay, so. And now you can see that's a little C chord. Right? So that's the next little bit, which is really amazing. He, once he comes up here and grabs the C arpeggio. So he's doing that pivot idea where he's, you know. I think he's, definitely done some heavy duty woodshedding, man, because this guy's got some nice, you know, string hopping exercises under his belt for sure. Really amazing playing. So, let's just chunk that out, okay? So that's the 5-3 and root of our C chord we're playing over. 9. That's the 9th, okay? It's the D note over the C. It's pretty amazing. Back to root, okay? Then slide up from flat 3 into 3 and then string hop. That's really cool, man, because he's... That's really hip. All right, and then back to root, 5-9 root. Okay, so all in. And now we're over the G chord again. So over that C chord is... Okay, so to put it in context, again, I'll try to play it slow, play along with me, slow me down 75% to 75%, and you'll have better audio, and you won't be hearing any backing tracks. It's really tough to hear some of the stuff because he's burning, but this is what I believe is happening. If we're coming out of, let's say, that... at the end there. We'll take it from that point. We'll take it up to that point when I come back, but that's it. All right, so after the C arpeggiated section, we start over a G chord again. That's this. Okay, so over the G chord we start on the downbeat on the 5, but there's a and. Okay. So the lick starts kind of, it precedes the downbeat by hitting that, the G note, okay? Okay? It's important to give it a little sing, I think. You can't just go, right? Then we're gonna do that position shift slide up into the third of the chord that he likes to do. Okay? That's the G arpeggio, right? Big stretch here, index finger comes back and grabs the root of the F chord we're about to play over. So, oh, sorry, I screwed that up. Okay, and that's how we navigate through the G, F, and C chord. The C chord is done with a third in the bass as well, right? So this is the G. This is the F, and this is the C. Sorry. Okay, so. Little pivot back and forth between. Very clever. Get into the third of our C chord, right? That's the C arpeggio. Back to G. All right, so let's look at that. G. F. C. And then over G, we'd start out using this little melodic motif. Sorry. Happening there, he's going to start to do that kind of blooming flower melodic thing. After all that scaly arpeggiated stuff, he usually shifts things around and then develops a melodic idea and then makes it explode and then shifts into the more, you know, notey playing. So this is a good example of that. Okay, so we're coming up out of that So over that C arpeggio, okay, it's definitely a little crowded in there, you know, this kind of, I think some people might just use one finger. I like the ability to articulate each note a little bit cleaner. I'm not sure how he's doing. I've never seen him play the solo. He doesn't waste time playing note for note versions of his own stuff like I am. But there you go. So this is really, really a killer line. So that's how I get it. And then I come over. Now, I'm not sure when he's pivoting here. I kind of just do a dead note to get up into that, right? But he may be going, or I think it just sounds like a pick thuck, okay? So. And now we're here with our index finger ready to play the next note, okay? But don't play like a dyad. Don't do that. It sounds sweet, but he doesn't play it, okay? So last time, 1, 2, 3, 4, and F. That's over C. Okay, so as you play that, we're gonna just go. I try to take my middle finger off right before I press the C note. Sometimes I leave it on too long and I get that kind of that effect, but it's a little cloudy. All right, so that's a really cool little series of notes of his. And also, whenever possible, try to get those little, you know, upward pinch harmonic things together. They really help kind of create the effect. All right, so much like earlier in the solo where he kind of takes a kernel of melodic information and then sort of has it spiral out of control until it finally breaks out into our more arpeggiated or soaring, searing high anthemic stuff, he's gonna do that same thing. The strategy here is very, very consistent. And, you know, Trey definitely is working this idea of this moving from the C note to the B note and, you know, kind of exploiting what's happening there. So that's going to be over the G chord. We're going to be hearing sus4 releasing to the third. Then we're going to hear 5 going to flat 5. And then tonic going into major 7 over the C chord. Okay. And, you know, you'll see where it's headed pretty quickly, okay? There are a few little tricks that he likes to do, though, to keep it fresh. So just like that section earlier, where it's kind of variations on the theme. Like, you know, he'll do that the second time and the third time, and then finally it just starts to expand, all right? Same kind of idea happens right here. Really amazing section of this music. So let me play it for you slow, and then you can even slow me down further, or you can go and get looping software or something like that. If anybody's curious, I use this device. It is my best friend when it comes time for transcribing. This is the Vidami video looper. And because I do most of my work in front of my computer, it plugs right into YouTube and I can just loop a section of music, whether it's a live concert or in this case, most of Phish's and most music is actually available just on YouTube as well. All right, so get yourself something like that, so that you're not kind of constantly messing around with scrolling back and forth and having to take your hands off the guitar. It's a real drag. All right, so we're coming out of that. That's the first bit. So we do 2 in a row that are the same. third one, we slide up. Try using those two fingers, okay? Because coming up, you're gonna need this index finger. It's nice to have it in reserve, okay? So, and don't forget, the first one, you're probably gonna start out playing with your index finger, so. Okay, so after the third one, we anticipate the C. We come right down the 12th fret, and then we slide up into the third of the G chord. So, one, same, slide. So, that last one, we anticipate that C, okay? So, sorry, let's take it from this position. One, two, three, and. Slide, anticipate. Okay, we'll go through that whole chunk right there when I come back. All right, so sorry to cover some of the ground again, but it always helps to hear the next little bit of the solo by what preceded it, okay? If you don't understand where you're at within the context of this format, it's such a long solo that it is integral that you actually kind of memorize it, because it's like doing a soliloquy or something like that. It's really, really a long piece, and it's easy to kind of get lost. So if we're coming up and we're looking at that that kind of developed idea, right? So the first is straight, again, slide, anticipate. Okay, so we're right there. We're gonna reach down with our middle finger and we're gonna grab. See how we kind of jammed back in there real fast with that that E note with the slide. So, that's every other, okay? We use that E note on the first and the third, on the second and the fourth times we play this little motif. We just go and play it, the notes that we're alternating through, we play them there. Okay, so we would go. Okay, then we're gonna slide. Okay, real fast. So it's. So that's, see how that's plain, plain, slide, plain. That's the way I organize it in my mind, okay? So here we go, come up. That's a true pivot lick. So E, C, E, C, B, B. And then again, he alternates to not adorning it with anything. He doesn't gussy it up on the second half. Let's play it from that pivot lick again, and I'll take you up to the very end of it. Okay, so. We're doing a lot with that ring finger. There's a lot of. Again, we're utilizing this little area quite a bit. So pivoting off that E note a lot. And once we do that, B note, we come into this little idea. So when you're doing the E, D, B, then F, E, D, then I slide. So I slide the G to F, and then I put my ring finger, or, right? So it's E, A, G, F. I don't do it all. I don't do it all on the high E string. I use some economy picking, and you know, I'm selective about actually which notes I'm playing there. I think he flubs, or not flubs, but does a mute rather than actually articulating each note a couple of times. So if you're really psycho about this, you'll break it down. So if we do. See that? That's a flub note. But it's, I can hit it, I just, all right, so we're coming up. So one, two, three, and then. Close, I kind of flub-a-dub-dat a little bit there, something happened. Okay, we've made our way up to that big high D, right? So, then we're just gonna hit C one time and just let it kind of go sine wave, no vibrato. Then two times with vibrato and then back down the G major scale. Sorry, C major scale. Okay. Flat, and then we start. Get to that D, and then we have to jump an octave up and grab that high fret again. So, sorry. Again, but this time, straight to the singing, and then. Okay, and that's. This is what I think he's trying to play, but this second time he hits that F, it's just a, it's not an actual note. Okay, so. That's kind of the main landmarks of it. He has a little bit more slide, a little pinch harmonic at the end. It's really beautiful what he does. So, all in. One, two, 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 jump, two, that's the second to last lick. So we're going to start here coming up into the third of the G and hitting the G note on the 15th fret high E string. So we're kind of playing, but again, we pivot. We do not sustain one over the other, okay? So that's kind of his thing, is holding an arpeggiated shape and then kind of pivoting around it, you know, like a chord shape rather, and arpeggiating by pivoting and constantly kind of bouncing, or, you know, but he's really good at this, okay? So we come up and grab that 15th fret high E, give it a little of that Clapton upward wiggle, right? Same idea, down two frets, right? So we've got the G chord, the F chord, and that's kind of what I hear happening. I think he might be, I think he might be hitting a G to A there. I can't quite tell. So G, F, and it's not quite as, connected to the kind of string exercise-y sound of these kind of pivot licks, but as he's going through this F chord, all right, it's not quite as clean as that. He's kind of more, kind of hinting at it. So we're doing kind of that effect. That pre-bend to let down with the harmonic. Really cool. I mean, it just shoots off into outer space. Really killer. So G, F. Pre-bend, let it down. But this A note is kind of muted. Right? Okay. So again, kind of a pivot lick off of that D string. Off on that G. All right, and here's where he does some kind of out stuff here. He starts this lick on the B flat here. I screwed up on the take that's at the beginning of this lesson. I just did. I'm not sure why he does a C7 arpeggio over the G chord, but it's cool. This is what he's doing. He's starting on the B flat and releasing into the third of the G chord. And that's it. So this last lick is actually mercifully easy. And I don't alternate pick this kind of line. I just go, sorry, I might do an upstroke there on that B note. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Then I shift positions and use my ring finger to, like that. Okay, and that's going. Very, very cool idea to end on the 9 there. Okay, so he's over. Like that. Very cool. So, we're. Cool song. Love this song. Thank you, Bud. Thank you. Thank you for recommending this tune to me. Really appreciate it. The shout out goes to my Phish fans. Definitely, definitely happy you guys asked me to do some Phish. Super happy. This is part of the cycle that I love about being a teacher, is that sometimes the curiosity of my students can actually, get this old codger curious himself. Okay, so truly fascinated by Trey's playing on this song, and I wish you luck with it. It is an advanced solo, and at tempo, it can present quite a challenge. All right, if you like what you heard or saw or learned, please leave a comment below, like, subscribe, do all that jazz. I really appreciate it. There's gonna be a link to my PayPal if you guys wanna, you know, tip me or something like that. It's no big deal either way. All right, take care, and I'll see you soon. Cheers.